Hi, and welcome to Xylos Cloud Chat. My name is Tim Jacobs.
And I'm Geert Baker.
And today we're going to talk about fault domains and how the new release of Infrastructure as a Service V2 impacts what we actually are used to already in Azure. So Geert, is it correct to say that a fault domain is like a rack in the Microsoft data center?
Yes, indeed. It's like a rack. If you take a look at the diagram that we have here, you can see that you have your compute resources when you put them into Azure. They're typically spread in a resource pool. And when you're deploying your application, if you want to have some level of high availability, you need to ensure that you deploy these resources across different fault domains. Because as you see, these fault domains or these racks, typically the machines have a single power supply. They have a single top of rack switch, the racks. They don't go as far in redundancy as you would typically do in an on-premises environment.
So on-premises, you would typically focus more on hardware redundancy to ensure high availability with multiple power supplies, with multiple top of rack switches. And in the cloud, this is apparently not the case. So it's only in the cloud that the concept of a fault domain becomes important.
Yes, indeed. These mega vendors, these big cloud providers, they typically don't go for this full redundancy at the hardware level. They go for scale out, simplicity at the hardware level. And you have to ensure, as a developer or somebody who deploys infrastructure, you have to ensure that your resources are deployed across these fault domains and to make sure that if there's some kind of hardware fault at the cloud provider, that your application is not impacted in its entirety.
Okay, and so how do you do that? Deploying an application or service across multiple fault domains?
Yeah, in Azure that's done with what they call an availability set. So when you deploy a VM, you specify the availability set for the VM. For example, you might have an availability set called my set, something like that. When you deploy your VMs within such a availability set, the system will automatically spread the VMs across the different fault domains that it has.
Okay, so it is done automatically, which is very convenient.
Absolutely. You just put your VMs in the availability set. That's all you have to do.
Okay, great. Now, recently, Microsoft has announced the concept of IaaSv2 VMs, so version 2 of the infrastructure as a service. So what's the difference between version 1 and version 2 machines?
Yeah, there are actually quite a lot of differences. If you look at the screen again we have here, you can see that we have IaaS version 1. That was handled by a system called Azure Service Management. IaaS version 2 is handled by what they call the Azure Resource Manager. Now, there are many differences, and we won't go today in all the details about these differences. But one of the big differences between these two types of systems is that when you configure an availability set, and again, that's what you have to use to make sure you are putting your VMs in different fault domains, within the old system, you got two fault domains. Couldn't change anything about that. That was the maximum number of fault domains that you got. Now, that can be a problem for several types of infrastructure. I'm thinking of a SQL Server always-on solution. Typically, you have two nodes for SQL and a witness node, so you have three nodes. You need some kind of majority. But think about it, you have three nodes and two fault domains in an availability set. You might have two nodes, or you will have two nodes in one rack. If that rack goes down, you lose majority and your cluster is down. So the top request when it came to fault domains was we need to have three for those kinds of specific scenarios. Yeah? And recently at the Build and Ignite conferences, Microsoft announced this IaaS version 2 style of VMs under the Resource Manager. And there you declare your availability set in a little bit of a different manner. We'll see in a moment how we do that. And then by default, if you declare your availability set and your VMs, if you create them in a specific way, you will get three fault domains by default. So from now on, you should deploy a SQL Server always-on cluster or other types of solution that depend on three nodes with voting and so on. You should use this new style of deployment.
Okay, great. And how you do it, deploying in version 2 VM?
Yeah, well, let's take a look at that. I've opened up Visual Studio 2015 release candidate here.
Visual Studio? I thought we were talking about infrastructure, so...
Yeah, well, you know, Tim, that DevOps is all the rage these days. So as an infrastructure guy, you need to do some development and vice versa as well. The reason I'm using Visual Studio here is that this resource manager, is using JSON files. These are files in a specific format. And Visual Studio has a nice visualization of these resource files, because they can become quite lengthy and it can be difficult to navigate in something like Notepad, which is perfectly fine. If you want to use Notepad, go ahead. I prefer Visual Studio.
Yeah. So people can use their favorite JSON editor to create such a
file. Yeah, it doesn't really matter. So if you don't like Visual Studio for some reason, then you can use something else. Now I've opened up a file here. This is a template that will deploy a set of load balanced virtual machines. Now this template is actually one way of creating IaaSv2 VMs. You could also just use PowerShell and then use an imperative style of deployment by just handing over commands to the system and it will deploy your resources. This is more like a declarative style of creating your resources. So you choose which one fits you. This one, of course, I think is a recommended approach to go. But you can see here you have all kinds of parameters within the file. Won't go into all the details. You have some variables, for example. And important here, I have a variable called AV set. That will be the name of my availability set, which of course you can change to whatever you want to do. And then I have some resources, types of resources that I'm going to build with this resource file. I need a storage account for my storage of my virtual machines. And then I declare the actual availability set within this system. So this is the new way of deploying a V2 style of availability set here. Then I'm going further. I'm creating a virtual network, some network interfaces to attach to my VMs. And then I'm creating the actual virtual machines. If you look at the virtual machines, in this case, we're using the copy parameter, using what we call a virtual machine loop. We specify a number of instances to deploy. And the number of instances, I've chosen them to be 3 in this case. And by the way, one of the advantages of this new system is that these VMs will be deployed in parallel with the old system. Your VMs will be deployed serially. So if you deploy a large number of VMs, this is also an advantage of the new system.
Yeah, it's much faster to deploy.
It's much faster.
For example, 100 nodes to do some big data processing.
Absolutely. It's much simpler. You hand off the file to the resource manager. He takes care of the whole serialization and parallelization of deploying all the resources. Of course, we won't go into details in what this file contains. It can be quite large, but it's very flexible. Then I would actually deploy these resources, what we call a resource group within Azure. This deployment is done either from Visual Studio, it has nice integration with Azure, so deploy, and then I would deploy this system to my Azure subscription. Or I could just use a PowerShell file. If I open up the PowerShell file, the critical line here is that, first of all, I'm switching to the new resource manager mode using PowerShell, and then I'm telling him, deploy a new resource group, use the template file and the resource, the template parameters that I actually specified, and just start and create my resources. You probably want to see what the result is.
Of course.
The deployment. Yeah. So let's go to the new, or let's say the preview Azure portal. Here you can see the resource group that we deployed. So it has a couple of resources, the availability set, my virtual machines, also a load balancer in front of these virtual machines. And if you click on the availability set, you'll see here that he specifies the number of full domains that this set will use. And indeed, he takes 3, I deploy 3 virtual machines. He will have spread my virtual machines across the full domains, which means that in this case, I have 1 virtual machine per full domain. Of course, if I would deploy 100 virtual machines, it would nicely distribute all these virtual machines over these 3 full domains in this case. This is the new way, of course, of deploying your resources. If you deploy a SQL Server always on cluster now, you should use this kind of method to do it.
So starting from now, we all have to deploy infrastructure using JSON.
Absolutely. It's fun.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you a lot for that information, Geert. That's it for today, and see you on our next Cloud Chat. Bye.
Bye-bye.